to make it a wonderful event. I would, of course, like to very warmly thank my co-president, Professor Alfa-Tobias, for all the assistance along those 2 years that we've been co-presiding the association together. And I wish you, I don't know if 25, but it's a very long time together to see the association prosper. Last but definitely not least, Daniel Nehemia has helped me, and he's been a lifesaver for me, at least to help this conference come along. And again, I would like to stress that if you would like to support EU-Israeli relations and the discussion of EU-Israeli relations, that you can become a member of the association, learn more about the integration, European integration, and help us make such wonderful events. So please, give the round of applause. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Maya, for your kind words, and to the association for organizing this event. I think we had a very interesting presentations thus far, and now we're moving to the roundtable debate on the topic Israel-European Union relations, the road ahead. And we have the pleasure to have in this panel Ms. Rachel Azaria, who's a member of the Knesset, former mayor, deputy mayor of Jerusalem. I had the pleasure to meet a few minutes ago. Mr. Dan Katarilas, an old friend from the Manufacturers Association in Israel. Dr. Aaron Lerman from the Begin Sadat Center for Strategic Studies, where he will soon be moving to a new think tank here in Jerusalem. Barak Ravid, the diplomatic correspondent from Eretz, will also be moving soon to a different job, I understand. And then another old friend, Alfred Tobias, co-president of the association. So I'd like to abuse a little bit of the panel, if you allow me. As you know, I will be presenting my credentials on Monday, so I'm still in a fortunate position to be a SIAF ambassador, but I will soon not be able to play that card. So I need a good advice and good insight on the way ahead of the EU-Israeli relations. So I'd like to suggest a few questions for the panel. Looking back at my predecessor's time in Israel, I see a stalled peace process, differences between the EU and Israel on issues like settlements, expansion, but at the same time a lot of progress on other areas of EU-Israeli cooperation. Horizon 2020 was signed, and I see Marcel Chaton and Sierra, who is one of the founding fathers of that program.
X.
Yeah, you are founding father, you remain for life. We also signed the Obetskaya Agreement with an incredible amount of intensification of tourism and contacts as a consequence. And then we developed a counter-terrorism dialogue, and these are only three examples of the main things that happened in that. So I'd like to ask the panel what they see, what are their predictions in terms of things we should expect in the 4 years to come. Then I also see a contradiction between the improving links that I just referred to, and particularly the increased people-to-people contact that we've seen. I'd like to also welcome the Spanish ambassador that is here with us today. And he mentioned during the National Day the other day that 300,000 Israelis, I think that's the number he gave, are visiting Spain on
the
more than that. And if we bring together all the European countries, the number of Israelis visiting Europe is quite amazing. But at the same time, there is also a continued or even growing trend of negative perception in Israel vis-à-vis the EU and vice versa. So why is that? Why, if we can say effects on the ground in terms of contact, links, economic interest, don't have a positive impact in the perception we have of each other? What does
Israel want most from its relationship with the European Union, and what the EU wants from Israel? That's the other question I'd like to listen to the panelists. Then a question of the regional situation. Europe seems to feel the consequences of a failed state crisis in the Middle East even more than Israel. I think Israel, in a way, has managed to insulate itself from the upheavals all around, while we've been directly affected, particularly because of refugee flows that are directly or indirectly linked of conflict coming from Syria and Libya. Do you think that the EU and Israel really see security threats differently, and why did so? EU-Israel relations are often grounded on our shared values. We always say this is an important common element. We believe in democracy, we believe in human rights, and we believe in rule of law, in the rule of law. Do you see any threats to these shared values in Israel, but also in Europe? And what impact this can have on our bilateral relations? And then finally, the question of identity. Is there a problem in resolving some of the perhaps inherent conflicts between what some see as European post-national identity and tendency to universalism, and Israel's particularity and self-definition as the homeland of the Jewish people? Or perhaps this description of identities is simply a caricature, and there's a different evolution in recent time. So I'd like to put these questions to the panelists. You're not obliged to answer them all, but you're obliged to answer them in 10 minutes. Thank you. And I'd like to start with Ms. Rachel Azaria, please.
Now we're kind of paying the price of the changes that were in the past.
I think that the future and the solution has to do with identity and with religion. I'm an Orthodox Jew, has to do with identity and with religion, but I think that the way we need to perceive the identity and religion is in a very different way than it was perceived in the past. I will give it in a few, a bit about Israel, and then I'll refer a bit to Europe. Thankfully, you presented me. I'm a former deputy mayor of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is a city that we have no other choice but to deal with the fact that everyone is here and no one's going to disappear. I think that in the past we had this notion that, you know, if we really, really hope so, someone will disappear. And everyone knew exactly who they hoped would disappear: Jews, Arabs, Christians, Muslims, ultra-Orthodox, liberal Jews. Everyone knew exactly who they would prefer that would disappear. And I think that what we're starting to understand is that no one's going to disappear and everyone's here to stay. And I think from liberalism, that kind of, you know, we're going to erase the difference. What we're trying to do now is to enjoy the differences and enjoy also the idea that a lot of people here are religious. I think that we see it, it's starting more with the form of arts. It's not yet not in diplomacy, not in politics, we're far away from that, but we see that we can change the discussion and turn it into, you know, let's, because we all believe in God, let's see how we can look for a solution for the city that is holy. And it's starting more with forms of art, but I do think this is something that's going to be, I think this is something that's going to go much more into the mainstream. It is very different than the Oslo Accords. I think that then that's going to be part of the solution with the Palestinians. I think it's hard to see it coming, but that's where I think that we're going. And I see it also, and this is an easier part to describe, I see it also with everything that has to do within the Israeli, the inner Israeli conflicts. One of the questions you asked was about the different regulation that legislations that are now being introduced in Israel, and you were wondering about Israeli democracy. I don't know if you said it in such a radical way, but you know, what is actually happening here? And I think that what is happening is that we are trying to form our identity. If you think of the pyramid of needs by Maslow, he described the needs of every person, every man and woman. But when you think about it, I think it has to do also with the pyramid of needs of a nation. And if you look at the state of Israel, so every generation had to fulfill one of these needs. The first generation was, you know, the independent. They had to establish the state of Israel. That's the 40s and the 50s, the 60s and the 70s. Those were the big wars: the Six-Day War and the Yom Kippur War, and that's the second stage. And then the 80s and the 90s was the economic generation. And now we're in the generation that I feel that more than anything we're trying to bridge the economic gap, dealing with housing, dealing with expensive living, these kind of things. And I think that the next stage is going to be everything that has to do with our identity. What does it mean to be an Israeli? What does the state of Israel stand for? What does it mean that we're a Jewish state? How do we form our identity and how do we relate to countries around the world? And more than anything, it would also be part of how do we relate to the Palestinian Authority, to the Palestinians. This is something that we still don't know how to do. Now, every one of these challenges looks like a huge challenge and no one knows how we'll ever manage to deal with it. But what happens is that once we reach the challenge, we can do it. So what we're seeing now, I would say in little harsh words, but I think that we're in a cultural civil war. And we're basically, there's a cultural civil war, those would be the words, to figure out what kind of state we want to have. Now, if you compare it to the United States, also they, 80-something years after the United States were born, they went through their civil war. Today, thank God, you know, it's not a real war, but what we're doing is we're working very hard and we're dealing with these effects. Now, I know that when you look from outside, you're like, what's going on? What is this government doing? I'm in this government, I'm part of the coalition, and I definitely feel that we're going through a cultural civil war, trying to figure this out, and it's a real combat. The daily combat. I think that's what's going on, because the idea is to figure out the identity. And I'm going back to the 90s, the years then when we thought that
identity isn't so important. I think that today we realize that this is a critical notion for the future. I think that more than anything, we have to figure out our own identity as the state of Israel. And I do think that that would be the next stage for any kind of conflict resolution with the Palestinians. I think we would figure out, I hope we'll figure out our identity, and it won't be the identity that says we're not them. And I hope that they would have time to figure out their identity, and I think that would be the future. I think that we're still trying to figure out what we see that's happening today with the glasses that we bought in the 90s. I have glasses in the 90s. And the glasses that we bought in the 90s. And I think that we don't have the vision and the capability often to realize the changes that are happening. And I think that what's happened, what it causes, is that we're kind of trying just to answer to what we see. And we're not yet in a stage where we can vision the future and realize where we're supposed to walk towards. I think in Israel, it's pretty clear to me what the future is. We're talking about probably a decade of these huge fights within Israeli society to figure out our identity. And then I think that, you know, and then we'll move on to the next stage. And I think that the relationship with Europe, something that's very important, is first what I think to realize that this is what's going on. And that's what we're dealing with. And I do think that there's a lot of stunning together, because I think that in a sense also Europe is going through something very similar. Sunni identities are becoming very important, which in the 90s weren't as important. Sunni religion, we see what's happening in different countries throughout Europe. I think also the fact that you have the refugees coming in, suddenly people start to discuss what their identity is and what does it mean to be Austrian, or what does it mean to be German, or what does it mean to be every one of these countries when you have these waves of people coming in and you're wondering, you know, are they going to become part of who we are, or aren't they going to become part of who we are? And I think that I think that probably what has to be done as kind of the Western world is to figure out, you know, where are we marching towards, what's the future we want. And going back to the 90s, I think in the 90s it was clear. I think that today we still don't have it organized enough so we can march in that direction.
Thank you very much. Well, I'll try not to. First of all, I want to thank the organizer, because this is really a nice occasion to wish you 25 years for the association. I want to wish you a very interesting stay, as interesting as the first one that you were here. I can assure you that there is never a dull moment in Israel. You can be sure of that. Now, I won't go into number of classes to those high ideas. I very much hope we are not in civil war and we're not going over there. And I don't want to enter into discussion whether we are in a democratic country or a Jewish country, that comes first. I come from the private sector. I think that the economy is still very, very important. Everybody in the morning has to go up to go and work and to find and wants to educate the kids. And the major issue, economic issue nowadays, it's true, we have identity, we earn a lot today. But on the economic side, I would just emphasize what's probably something that people have talked enough in Israel, probably not emphasized enough, is that Europe is and will be in the next certainly decade the major market of Israel. And we tend to forget it. We tend to put Europe for granted. But I just want to remind all of the people here, not only businessmen here in the room, 40% of our imports come from Europe, and 35, even more than that, also go to Europe. So, and this is a constant. It hasn't changed. It hasn't increased much, because Europe doesn't grow as, let's say, China, okay? But it hasn't decreased either. It's true that the competition in Israel has been changed a little bit. It's true that, by the way, the export to the United States has been going down a little bit, but the one to Asia has been growing. But if, and I have a figure here, I told them to prepare myself for today. So if you look at the constant of the last 15 years, we are approximately around the same figures, with a little bit of ups and downs, with a change in the composition, which are the country, which are the first one, the second one, etc. By the way, it's interesting. It used to be Germany for a while, now it's the UK. So it's interesting to know with the Brexit what could happen. So it's a challenge for us in terms of economics to see what will happen, because today the UK is our major
actually partner in Europe. So we have to see how the transition will come. Okay, we are not happy with Brexit. I don't think that any economist that has his mind right is happy with Brexit. Never mind. We heard about it today. We have challenges, but I think that the constant of Europe and the problem is that there is a dissonance between the way the Israeli public looks at Europe and the attitude of the Europe and the reality on the ground. Okay, we consider Europe as being anti-Israeli, they are all against us, all anti-Semites, etc. I mean, I don't want to do that, but you, I mean, you've been here, it hasn't been better since 10 years. I mean, the image of Europe in Israel hasn't improved in the last 10 years. The way, by the way, the image of Israel in Europe hasn't improved in the last 10 years. So we have a problem of image. But when we look at the reality on the ground, it's totally different. And when you look at the investment, for instance, Israeli investment in Europe, I came back this morning from Brussels, I heard figures like $45 billion of Israeli investment in Europe in the last 10 or 15 years, much less, by the way, European investment in Israel. Okay, so we provide a lot of jobs there, you provide also, but you start to understand that something is happening. Okay, I mean, now, if you look at the last 5-6 years, the number of R&D centers of European companies coming here is not as the American, it's a bit more than the Asian, and it's been increasing. So Europe is understanding that the Israel has something to offer. As not a market only, because we're a small market, but as a platform to work together for the global market. So you're looking what's ahead for you in the next 4 or 5 years. If you decouple politics from economics, you are on the good ground. If you continue to pollute the relation with politics, we have no problem. Okay, because this is the thing that, and for minute things, I mean, I'm not going to enter into the figures of how much we export from the territories or how much the amount, but the fact is that this is the focus of the relation is ridiculous. We have to focus on the positive side. We have to focus on what we can move ahead. We have disagreement, we can have disagreement, we can disagree politically, but the economy, you have a lot of things to do. And when I'm talking economy, I'm talking about in the large terms of economy. For instance, we as a private sector, we maintain contact with the Economic and Social Council. So the social dialogue, I'm not just talking about import, export, and investment. I'm talking about vocational training issues. I'm talking about issues of relation between unions and civil society. I mean, there is so much that we have in common that we can develop, but we have to understand, we have to regain credibility in Israel, because I think there's a problem for credibility. We probably also have to regain credibility in Europe, but when you look purely at the economic side, I think it's very, very positive. I just made a list of NNB. I just heard that now you have a map, there's a new project of the map of the Mediterranean in terms of waterways and logistics, etc., which plenty can be done. I think the map that was published now by DG Connect, DG Move, I mean, they found a solution. When they published the map, there is no borders and there is no capitals in the map. Why? Because not because of Israel only. Because there are other places in the region where the borders are not decided. And when so when you want to find a solution, you find a solution. In Israel, we heard today from Mr. Hampaz, and I asked him, that there is a different approach. We probably are more, I don't know, or either it's more interesting, or maybe there's more, that you focus in Israel on those issues, but in other countries you don't focus in the same way as you focus here. There is a double standard, no question about it. Okay? So, but thank God, I think that, God, never mind, but the fact is that... Think tank that is called the X Group. We've been working for 12 years together to present the economic aspect of the relation and how Europe can have a positive role in developing relation between Israel and Palestine on the economic side. There is a huge place for Europe to encourage, to develop to help, to assist. Unfortunately, I think that it's true, you are the biggest donor to the Palestinian. When you look at the result, I don't have to tell you, when you look at the result of the neighborhood policy, I don't have to tell you. So you probably have to change the approach to the region using new ways. The economic way, I think, is one of them. And I think there's a lot that can be done, not only with Palestinian, with the region. I mean, I can go deep into details about what we have with the Americans, with the quiz, which is an example of a triangle, example where actually the Americans are helping cooperation us and Egypt even during the Morsi time, when helping cooperation, economic cooperation, creating jobs for the Egyptians, etc. The issue of accumulation of origin, pan-European rule of origin, all those things, there is, you could find flexibility. I don't want to bother people with the details of that, but you just finished an agreement, I understand, with Jordan, with a lot of flexibility on rule of origin, because you understand that you have to help Jordan to overcome with the refugees, etc. So then you can be more flexible in finding solution. If there is a will, there is a way. That's the Chinese say, by the way, the Chinese also. You have to, I mean, I was talking to the people of DG Move. I mean, we are on the Chinese screen for the Silk Road and for the and this is to connect the Asia to Europe, going through us geographically. Let's work together. Okay, that you don't have the money, the Chinese have the money. So let's work together. So there are a lot of ways that we can find say creative ways of going away from the negative agenda that unfortunately is on the table most of the time. And I'll continue later if I have a
question. I totally agree that from my experience, we tend to focus on the negatives unnecessarily. There's a huge agenda, broad agenda on the economic side. I need not elaborate on what you already heard. But let me make three quick points. You asked, what does Israel need from Europe? To a certain extent, what does Europe need from Israel? We need a bit less moral condescending, probably from both sides. But we've been the recipients for many years of an undertone of moral condescension, which, given the challenges that we've been facing here, is not completely justified. And the less this creeps into the conversation, the better. We can have our differences about specific issues, but when this is basically posited in language and in action, as Europe speaking down to us from a position of moral superiority, the results are bound to be exactly the introduction of this negative note and this negative reaction that you may expect under the circumstances. And I'm talking about interference in certain aspects of our certain balances of our domestic politics. I am speaking about choices that used to be made on the Palestinian issue. Speaking to Israel from a position of you are somewhat the offenders, and we, Europe, are here to educate you on the morally right position, is, I would say, counterproductive even for the purposes this is supposed to serve. My second point is actually related, because I think that we are about to see change in this very specific set of dynamics. Because I believe that increasingly there's comprehension, perhaps more in the member states than in the European institutional system as such, of the kind of challenges that we've been facing in Israel and facing effectively in Israel. I'm distinguishing here between the MS, sorry, between the member states and the EU as an institution, because it has been my observation over the years that between the two BBBs, big Brussels bureaucracies, the one downtown and the one in the Ver, there's a barrier, not only because the Turks insist, of course, that NATO doesn't speak to an organization which has Cyprus in it, but also because they are born under very different circumstances. NATO was born with an enemy in mind. The EU was born unable to spell the word enemy in terms of its concept of what the world is like. Unfortunately, we do have an enemy, and in fact, we have an enemy in common. As everyone knows now, if you've been walking the streets of Barcelona or London or Berlin or Brussels. And we have gained some insight into how to fight such an enemy without actually being dragged into the pits of populist hatred towards whole populations, which is, I think, the internal domestic challenge in Europe today. And the reason we've been able to do this is precisely because we have built a kind of institutional capacity that is relevant. People in Israel sometimes say, well, Europe is lost, there are 5% to 10% Muslims in some areas. Well, we have 18% Muslims, and we've managed this relationship quite well. Why? Because we have built a certain institutional capacity that we trust. And dialogue about the implications of this institutional capacity, how it works, what enables us to be what we are, and where we are, I think if it is free of some of these moral modifications on both sides, will be beneficial, will be strategically beneficial. And it will become more and more relevant in the coming years. And my third point, people who have read here and there something that I read and wrote would know my passion on the subject. I believe that when we speak about Israeli-European relations, we should speak about what I would call variable geometry of Israeli-European and specifically Israeli-Mediterranean relations. Not all Europe is the same. I think when you spoke about investment, I think most of it has gone to eastern parts of Europe, which have a very different perspective on Israel and Israel's history than you would otherwise. If you've been, you know, subject to the brutality first of the Nazis and then the Soviets, you have a different perspective on the Jewish experience than you may have elsewhere. Moreover, in the southern arc, I've seen a transformative change over the last 10 to 15 years. Who would have thought that there will be already three, coming, the fourth is coming up, trilateral summits between President Netanyahu, President Anastasiades, and Prime Minister Tsipras of Greece, a full range, I would say, of political opinion in Europe, from the center-right to the far-left, based on very profound strategic and economic commonalities. This is, I think, a building block. And Italy is coming in on the energy end, Croatia is coming in on emergency measures. The Eastern Mediterranean is becoming far more relevant to our future than it has ever been. The divide between the Middle East, an old colonial frame of reference, try to tell the Chinese that they are in the Far East, far from what? The Near East, the Middle East, these are Eurocentric concepts. The Mediterranean is a bridge, and it is, and we are building that bridge between Israel and two key European partners. And we are open. I think if you read carefully the statements that have been coming out from the trilateral meetings, you would see that this is open to broader participation in the Mediterranean region. It comes together with a close relationship of all three countries, with Egypt and Jordan. I think we are seeing a variable geometry emerging that will have very interesting implications, Italy as well being involved, and will have resonate in Brussels as well down the road.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I'll start from the bottom line, and then I'll try and explain. EU-Israeli relations are in the vector of EU-Israeli relations in the last since 2009 is only in one direction, which is downwards, and I don't see that changing. It's going to continue to deteriorate more and more. That's the bottom line. And I'll try and explain why. Explain a few characteristics of EU-Israeli relations. First, Israelis do not know and do not understand the EU at all. Okay? No offense to people in the room. And I'm sure that Rafi Barak here, the former Director General of the Foreign Ministry, will be able to be a good witness to this trend. That Israelis just do not know the EU, do not understand it, especially Israeli politicians, especially Israeli ministers, especially Israeli prime ministers that are in office since 2009. They just don't understand it. They look down on it, on the EU. They say that Europeans are naive. Okay, remember, Iran spoke about being condescending. Believe me, there's enough for that to go around. Remember Israeli ministers joking about Belgium and Belgian chocolate, okay, after terrorist attacks, okay, remember that? They say that, you know, Europeans are naive, they don't put any effort in security, they don't understand. Every European peacekeeping force in the region ran away when the first challenge came, especially the EU bomb. That's usually the example. Oh, they ran away once Hamas came from Rafah. Okay, regardless of what was their actual mandate. Okay, now Netanyahu is saying that Europe is he described Europe as crumbling economies. When there was the whole debate of Horizon 2020, he had this genius thought, oh, we don't need the EU, let's go to China and India. They'll give us billions of euros for joint R&D projects, no problem. So this is one thing. Another characteristic is that comes from a bigger trend that Israelis, especially Israeli politicians and Israeli diplomats, don't like and are very suspicious of multilateralism and multilateral organizations. We knew it from day one, from day one with the UN, and the EU is just another example. The Israeli government is using the EU as a punching bag for all of its foreign policy problems and failures. Okay, why? Because it's much easier to bash Brussels instead of the actual states that took the decisions in Brussels. Okay, it's much easier to describe the EU as this big demon instead of really saying, look, the EU is actually member states that are taking the decisions. And you even heard Iran just a few minutes ago said, we have much better relations with member states than with Brussels. Member states are Brussels, and Brussels is member states. You know, you can try and juggle any way you want. That's the reality. Okay, when the EU decided on labeling settlement products, okay, Israel took sanctions against the EU. When the real reason was that 17 member states wrote a letter to Federica Mogherini asking her to publish guidelines for labeling of settlement products, okay? Nobody called in the ambassadors of the UK and France and Spain and Sweden. I can go on and on and on and on. No, it was much easier to say it about the EU. And again, if we're talking about more condescending, which by the way is true, okay? It's not that Europeans are not morally condescending, but the problem is that Israelis are exactly the same. Okay, right, if you label settlement products, it's mean you rank the Semites. You forgot the Holocaust. Okay, you're doing the same thing, it's 1933 again. Okay, you haven't learned a thing. Okay, and Israelis, especially Israeli diplomats, and they do it very well, they take advantage of the fact that the EU mechanisms and Brussels is very complicated. And they try and they succeed many times in dividing between the member states, in trying to prevent certain decisions, and they succeed. And actually, I think if I look at it today after Brexit, because I wasn't sure before, but now I'm pretty sure that at least the current Israeli government is actually Eurosceptic. Okay, and we saw that. We saw that, and I heard that with my own ears a few weeks ago in Budapest in the Visegrad summit. Okay, when the mic was open and we could hear the conversation between Netanyahu and the prime ministers of Hungary, Czech Republic, Poland, and Slovakia. And it was quite amazing, not only, and I'm sure all of you, or at least most of you, read the transcript, but it wasn't the words, it was the music. Okay, it was the music and how Netanyahu embraced Orban, okay, and his ideas about the EU and about and actually not only interests but also Orban's values. And I think that this is the main problem today between Israel and the EU. We're in a crisis of values, because we used to say, you know, we have those cliches, we have them too with the US, and it's nonsense there, it's nonsense here, you know, shared interests and shared values. Unfortunately, there are not too many shared interests anymore between Israel and the EU, and there are also not too many shared values. And unfortunately, when there are shared values, we see them with Israeli officials flirting with radical right-wing neo-Nazi anti-Semitic parties in Europe, all over Europe, unfortunately. On the other hand, Europe also just does not know how to explain itself to Israel. No offense to anybody, but most European ambassadors in Israel just don't get it. They don't get the culture. Okay? They don't understand that this country is totally informal. Okay? And it's not only the fact that you don't have to wear a tie between June and September according to the protocol, but it's also the way people think and the way people analyze things. It's totally different. And most European ambassadors come here and they think that they're the ambassadors to Vienna or to The Hague. And no, you're in Tel Aviv, you're in Jerusalem, you're talking to Israelis. It's a totally different thing. And you can, and you know how you know that this is the case, because the ones that do get it are very successful. Unfortunately, and again, no offense to anybody, there are not too many of those, because people just don't get it. Why? So I think that all of those reasons we're going to continue with this trend of deteriorating relations. And there's another issue that will take us there, and this is pretty obvious to everybody, is the Israeli-Palestinian issue and the continued occupation. There's a linkage. Just remember, in 2000, I remember it because I was there, 2009, beginning of 2009, five or six European leaders came to the Prime Minister's office to support Israel after the war in Gaza. Okay? With a really a huge move of support. And since then, it's only on its way down. The relations are only on its way down. And again, I'm not sure everyone in this room will agree with me, but unfortunately I think that Israeli government policy has something to do with this trend, okay? And especially on the Palestinian issue. Since that time, since 2009, there's a linkage in EU-Israeli relations, a linkage between promoting their bilateral relations and between the peace process. It's not going to change. I don't see that changing at all. And some people in this country, some of them live on Balfour Street in Jerusalem, think that because the migration crisis, or because terrorism in Europe, or because Israeli high-tech, this linkage will sometime in the future, very soon, will disappear. No, it will not disappear. Or quite the contrary, this linkage will just get stronger and stronger. There's a reason there's no association council for years now, and there's a reason it's not going to take place, as long as I tend to assume that as long as this government here is in power, there will not be an association agreement, an association council. And this linkage is just going to get stronger and stronger, and not weaker, and it will have a very negative effect on the future of our relations.
It's good that there are so different opinions that can be exchanged here. I'm going to disagree with what my neighbor has been saying, but there is also logic in what he is saying. So I'm not saying that this is punk what he's saying, not at all. But basically, I would agree about the future, I'm speaking, not the past, the present. But the future, I would rather agree with Toby Green's and Reinhold's article this morning, we were not here, where he diagnosed a strategic opportunity to strengthen the relations between Israel and Europe for the following. I will give some reasons. Some he mentioned, but others he didn't. First, there have been tremendous changes in the Middle East. Israel has nothing to do with it. The civil war in Syria, the failure of the Arab Spring, by and large, but for example of Tunisia, it hasn't worked, which leads me to two things. First, I think that the Europeans, not only Europeans, but Europeans because they are neighbors of the Arab world, are desperate with the Arab world. I mean, the fact that Spain, Portugal, Greece, and other countries in Southern Europe that were Mediterranean knew how to transit from dictatorship to democracy, and that the Arab world 30 years later has been pretty unable to do it for different reasons, is a quandary that serious Europeans ask themselves. We ask ourselves as well, although like Israelis, we know everything better than the others. So we tend to say, we told you so, we told you so. We know the Arabs better than you, okay? That's my first remark, but it is a fact that I think that this has been a tremendous blow for the Palestinian case in Europe, because first of all, there are questions asked by the Europeans about the possibility of evolution in the Arab world, and second, because they have realized that the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is only the beginning, that solving the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is peanuts compared to solving the problem of Syria, to give you an example, or the Kurds, or because we are speaking about several more million people. Many million people more. Then there have been changes in Europe that go also in another direction, favoring an Israeli-European rapprochement, and this is that Europe is much more inward-looking than it was 10 years ago, because it has had its own problem. It is less pontificating, it realizes that pontificating was an easy part, but it cannot say we are the nice kids in the block, because now other people see that they have also problems, let's put it like this. So they are not the example that they used to be, and therefore they are revising, they are reconsidering, etc., etc. So the idea of projecting soft power, etc., is, in my opinion, a little less. So the motivation of sermonizing whoever, including Israel, is a little less. Now, about Euroscepticism in Israel. Israel has been Eurosceptic from the beginning, but for the 90s. In the 90s, Israel was very much pro-Europe, simply because the United States was pro-Europe. And if the United States said, they are doing the single market, what about us? So Israelis had to say, well, if the United States says that it's a problem, so we must take a watch. And this is how the EU got attention. And this is where the relationship or the consideration of the EU in Israel was at the best. But since then, it has been since always. Why? The Holocaust has much to do. When I arrived to this country, I remember very well that many people coming from France, from Germany, etc., etc., were telling me that this matter of the European Union won't work. We know the Europeans better than the European knows themselves. Okay? So that was the motto at the time. So Euroscepticism has here a long tradition, like it has in Switzerland and like it has in Britain. Okay? For me, it's not new. Now, the other point is what Israel wants from the European Union. Well, I think that even if it is not said openly, Israelis would like to be part of the family. It does not mean membership. That Europeans value us for what we are and what we are not. Not because we have a problem with our neighbors, but for what we are fit for and what we are not fit for, okay? So the question of being part of the family. I know that there are Israelis who say our main partner in life is God, okay? And the others is not important. We have a special deal with God, etc. Most Israelis, even religious ones, are realistic enough that this is not a very helpful motto. That we must look around what is there. And when we look around, and in spite of this government express efforts to diversify our relations, which I think it's good. Israel tries with China, tries with India, tries with everybody else. I mean, the simple answer to the question is that Israel is part of the West. If it is part of something, it is part of the West, and it will remain part of the West. Okay? Now, among the West, because of proximity reasons, geographic reasons, the only game in town is Europe, and in my opinion, it will continue to be Europe. And I will tell you now for what reason. The reason is that Israel over time has become a little, you are going to laugh, it has become a little Denmark in the Middle East. Okay? And that includes the fact that we are only 8 million. Okay? So when it comes to Israelis always despising Europeans, etc., etc., I beg you to check what happens with the Israeli the moment he takes the plane and arrives to Europe. Suddenly he becomes very small. Okay? Suddenly he realizes that in fact we are nothing. We are nothing. We are 8 million, all the time that they are in the Knesset or they are around in Tel Aviv, and the Europeans don't know. And, but when they arrive there, they realize that, oh, this is working, and this is nice, and this is very close to us, etc., etc. And let me tell you that low cost traveling is adding to this dimension more and more. Israelis leave aside a lot and leave aside all the Zimmerim of the north, etc., because Now they can go for a weekend outside, and this is very good. This is the biggest favor that the Likud, through Mr. Katz, has done. The open sky agreement. He doesn't know what he has been doing. Because if you are a Likud person, you should logically try to close your country to the outsiders. And instead of that, he does exactly the opposite, which is fantastic. And now, the other point that has changed the whole perception, in my opinion, of Europe about Israel is, surprisingly, the role, the serious role that Europe has with Turkey. I mean, this is an important dimension that Toby Green didn't mention. I think that Europe, like the United States, were thinking about two strategic allies. If everything goes wrong with Russia, if everything goes wrong with Iran, if we have always Turkey and Israel. Israel is the small brother, Turkey is the biggie. It's the NATO and this. With Erdogan, the Europeans are lost. They don't know what to do with this. They don't know. And we are speaking about a very, very important country for Europe, much more important than Israel. Now, of course, in my opinion, all the time that things go wrong with Erdogan, Israel is a good replacement. Now, you will say that I don't like this because we are second. But look at the energy picture. In the energy picture, what is one of the objectives of the European Union in energy policy? To be less dependent on Russia. It begins from that. Okay? In order to be less dependent on Russia, the idea was, well, we are going to have them through Turkey. Turkey is going to do us the business. Okay? But now Turkey is out. So we go down one step. And then we say, well, maybe Israel, it has a lot of gas, etc. So what I mean by that is that the Turkey factor has an influence on what Europe thinks about allies it has in the Middle East. And then, finalize. There was a time where in Israel there were some people telling me, with the internet and globalization and all this, there are no borders and distances are nothing, and this and that, etc. Well, there might be a time where this will be the case. Probably in 2500 or something. Okay? Still, proximity in terms of human proximity through language and other dimensions is still important. And for Israelis, I mean, even if they say, well, we are going to teach Chinese in the school, nobody believes that. Nobody believes that. Okay? Like when we were saying at the creation of the state, we are going to teach every Israeli to speak Arabic because we are from the Middle East. Bunk! Okay? This is not happening. Okay? Then the hope is that, oh, if we speak English, that's enough. Bunk as well. So the point is that by default, we are having to consider Europe all the time. And to finish, a little mention about Denmark, because I said Denmark. And I said Denmark because I didn't want to say Britain or Spain. What I mean by that is that if Britain can make the folly, and we say it's the folly, imagine, to go out of the European Union, well, we say, well, they are a little crazy, but they are Britain. 60 million people in a very well situated geographically with a lot of old friends, etc. Okay. But ask Spaniards, the Spanish ambassador, or Catalonians, I am Catalan, Catalonians, if they can do without Europe. Now they are speaking about leaving Spain, and when they are told that they will have to leave the European Union, they say, oh my. Now, that, no, we want to leave Spain, but not the European Union, okay? So, if they, Catalonia has the same dimension, a demographic dimension as Israel, and has the same GNP, or we have the same GNP as them, I mean, ask a Dane or ask a Catalonian if they want to leave the European Union, and they say, are you cuckoo? Okay? So, how, an Israeli could say, go to hell, we don't need you, etc. This is only for internal consumption. When they go there, they see that this would be a catastrophe.
Thank you very much to the speaker. I think I gave lots of fruitful thoughts for my 4 years. I hope some of them are right than others, but definitely very interesting. I don't know whether we have a few minutes for questions. We do. So perhaps I start over there and then I move here. Please, Tom.
So on your entrance, your new post, I would like to suggest two things. As you have heard from the panelists, to better communicate with the Israelis and the Israeli politicians. And I will focus, to be brief, on two misperceptions on either side. When the European Union, European officials discuss security, they talk or they think about committees convening. When you talk to Israelis about security, they imagine tanks moving and bombers sent on missions. So I suggest that whenever, and unfortunately there may be another security round in Israel, you are seen visiting troops and say all the criticism you have to say about get yourself photoed with some real guns in the background. That will connect you with Israelis that would understand that we talk security in the same way with all the disagreements. On the other side, you will have to deal with a wide perception in Israel that Europe is overtaken by Muslims. It won't help to ridicule people who believe that. This needs to be tackled. I think it would be a good idea for you to do your best to disprove this, what I consider to be a myth. But it is very prevalent even among people who consider themselves to be liberal and pro-Europeans. And I'd like to make a comment to Khan. I think people in the security apparatus of Israel, I think people, Prime Minister and people close to him, misperceive something about security in Europe. Security per se, or hard security, Israeli way of talking security, was never delegated to the European Union. It remains a member state issue. It's obvious that when you deal with these particular cooperations, I mean, between security officials on either side, that doesn't go through the European Union and it will not in the near future. But that does not come in place of proper relationships about security with the European Union bodies. It has to be covered in the neglect, as I understand it, from the leadership of Israel, of these European Union apparatuses. It is very, very unfortunate to us. Another final comment about chocolate people. I'm sure that anyone who is in the business of security appreciates that European counterparts in that issue are not made of chocolate. They know their job and they know what they're doing. It's just that when you have free movement of people in Europe, you're not going to get anywhere there if Germany doesn't go along. It doesn't help to be very strict and to find your own balance between privacy and security if Germany doesn't go on the same kind of compromise. And the Germans have their own history. You cannot frighten Germans with an axe attack in the train or an occasional truck that drives into a Christmas market when the alternative is to give up liberties when you have the Stasi or the Gestapo gain your collective memory. So if Israel wants to get at European cooperation the way Israel understands it, a lot of work needs to be done with the politicians in Germany.
Thank you. I see lots of hands raising. I think there was one over there, please.
There is a challenge to the idea that Israel and Europe are sharing values or share common values, but I think that demonizing elected officials on both sides, I mean, in Hungary or in Israel, doesn't necessarily serve the interests of those of us who have the best interests of those sides at heart, or would like to see them cooperate more. Rather, I think that this sort of demonization strengthens the void, the more problematic voices, as you would put them, that put them in power in the first place. It's not that there isn't, there aren't misconceptions or misunderstandings between the sides that need to be addressed. There are many of those. But both sides also have many common interests that should be dictating their relationship. And whilst it's okay for them to disagree, and it's maybe okay to criticize each other, I think that if you cultivate an all or nothing policy on either side, which I don't believe is part of the policy on either side, you may be wishful thinking and you may be talking out of political vengeance, but you're not analyzing the reality of either side. I think both sides understand the situation is complicated and it's getting more so, and that they need to create a sense of priorities and centering the relationship around one issue and deciding that that is the all or nothing definition of the relationship, again, is not a realistic view of Europe or Israel. I don't think either side is that childish or superficial.
Thank you. I would take Gerald and then the British ambassador. Sorry, the Spanish ambassador.
Since we're not asking questions but giving advice,
you can reach to the panelists.
Preaching to Europe.
The panelists, I'm sure, will have comments and responses also. But I will just add very quickly that my experience has been that there's not much communication between many parts of the European officialdom, including the EU and broad Israeli society. That there tends to be a very narrow dialogue, and I've been to many events that are held in houses and in delegations and other places within the European framework, not just the EU, but individuals. And a lot of the, I am always the odd man out, a woman out as the case may be, in most of these cases, because most people in those dialogues come from a very, very narrow sector of Israeli society. And therefore, what I've seen is that European officials are either very cynical or very surprised about the developments that take place in Israel, whether they are electoral developments, policy developments, and I think that's mainly from a lack of communication channels. Very often, in fact, I think when you were here in your previous round, you're the ambassador at that time, was very interested in Israeli-Palestinian track two. Mm-hmm. I went to some of them. I suggested Israeli-European track two between civil society groups, and I think that's still something that needs to be developed. You have a pretty good group of panelists here in terms of the broad spectrum. I would just advise you and other members of the European Diplomatic Corps and others to expand that, to go further on that. One other element of that, and that is that I see constantly and I hear constantly, and as part of the structure of the EU, back to the Venice Declaration. We are now 37 years away from the Venice Declaration. Alfred, I was part of that early 1980s. I have a chapter in that book, and I think part of that dealt with the Venice Declaration, and you hear constantly being repeated, including, of course, by the NGO community. It just doesn't apply anymore. So let's have a dialogue about where we can progress together and make it broad, across Israeli civil society and not simply narrow parts.
Gerald, I'd like to hear now a European voice and the ambassador of Spain.
Thank you. Well, my name is Manuel, so I had another reason to giving you a hand in a way. And I think that one of the most interesting things about this kind of panel, especially this kind of dialogue, is to see the intensity of the interest and the relation in the negative terms and the criticizing, but also the need to get closer, know more about each other. Israel, Europe. Europe is, as Mr. Barakovic has said, it's sometimes it's easy to criticize the group as such. It is the sum of its parts, it's individual countries, but it is also an organization that has a specialty and a life of itself. I think it's unique, really, in the history of international cooperation. It is not just any other kind of international organization. It has such a high degree of integration that it can be seen actually as developing policies or positions instead. So it does have a personality, so it is actually subject to evaluation, criticism, whatever. So the EU exists as such. It's difficult because you have to work among, now it's 28 countries, that's a lot, very difficult to realize a common ground and to establish policies. And once you establish policies, it's very difficult to move and to evolve. Normally it's very, very slow. But I think that the EU that has intense, excellent, and very often ignored the relations and importance, or is and vice versa, that has another dimension which I would like to mention, and it is the role in the whole of the Mediterranean. Israel sits together with Arab countries around the Mediterranean in the Union for the Mediterranean. This is an exceptional situation. It is an organization that is very, soft in, as far as competences, as power, but it's something that has been kept alive and has potentialities as far as developing cooperation among the different areas and regions of the Mediterranean. There is a lot to do there. It's something that I think Israel values. I have had the occasion to be participating in different ministerial, in the delegation of Spain, ministerial conference in Barcelona, and I saw that the participation of the Israeli minister was there with other foreigners from other countries with whom Israel doesn't have formal relations. It's a good positive way. The Union for the Mediterranean exists because of Europe and Europe exists as such. It's slow, you have to be patient, we all have to be in the same sense and effort, but I think it's a positive thing to take into account. Mr. Lehmann referred to the cooperation in East Mediterranean. It brought to my mind the experience of the 5+5. 5+5 is the Western Mediterranean countries of five European countries and five countries of the south, which are basically the Maghreb countries. We in Spain, as Mr. Professor Tobias said, we are close to the Arab world. It's a different world, but it's not the Middle East, this nomination, but it is also the Arab world. We do realize how complex sometimes relations can be and how important it is not only to have relations with individual countries, but also to try to foster relations among them. And my idea when I was listening to you, Mr. Lerner, is this trilateral with Israel, Greece, Cyprus, Italy, at a certain moment, even Egypt, why don't it do this kind of promise? This kind of logic of thinking, it comes from how being Europeans used to try to explore how to cooperate with one another. Sometimes utopian, but it's also practical. I think it's also here. One final point about my country: we have a situation now where there is a challenge to the rule of law. I was interested in the previous in the keynote lecture how many times there was a reference to how deeply and intimately are connected the principle of democracy, the principle of the rule of law, on and also the very existence of the European Union. This is the overarching question in my country now, that any kind of decision should be done through the reform of the laws that we have, the constitution and so on, but not breaking them and coming away from them. And my final point, far right or xenophobic parties are growing in Europe. Mostly we do have some exceptions, and happily one of them is in my country, also I think in other countries, but I know another one that I'm speaking about. We have about 10% immigration, we have more than 1 million Muslims as immigrants in Spain, We had back in 2004 the worst and most tragic jihadist terrorist attacks on trains in Madrid. Even then, we didn't see a backlash of strong, organized xenophobic reaction. We still don't have a party that thinks that they can gain votes through this kind of language. So this is something that is also good to, for me, and it's a duty for me, good to perform this duty to inform about this kind of this kind of society where in, even in Europe you don't have automatically this kind of reaction. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manuel. There's a person next to you. If you can introduce yourself.
Yes, so my name is Ina Cooper. I'm researching and teaching at RIF University at the Department of Political Science. I'm researching also on European politics and migration, and I try to understand the Israeli culture now for 2 years. And I think I will take more time, but I can agree already with a lot. It's a bit irritating for me, maybe, to say, if you are thinking about the Europe and Israeli relationship, it's Europe, it's so, we have, consists of different countries, and Europe is not a country, so there are so many countries, so many countries.